you know you are on the right track, if you have this inner knowledge, then nobody can turn you off, no matter what they say. Barbara McClintock. Let's make the future. Welcome to Let's Make the Future, a discussion about future trends, technologies, and their implications for human society. We are coming to you from all over the world, featuring the voices of Michael Curry, Daniel Valenzuela, and Parnion Barakatane, with guest panelists Tobias Wagner, also featuring Anita Vadavata. Music and editing, Christian Peltonen.
Welcome to Let's Make the Future. Let's introduce ourselves.
Hi, I'm Daniel, a mathematician and social impact enthusiast. I'm based in Munich and happy to be on the show.
I'm Michael Curry, an independent software developer and entrepreneur from Canada, currently living in Thailand.
Hi, I'm Toby. I'm a mobility entrepreneur based in Munich. I'm the CEO and co-founder of ChargeX, an e-mobility startup here in Munich, and glad to be on the show today.
We're glad to have you.
We are.
This episode's future trend discussion topic, solar energy.
Solar energy has been experiencing an exponential rate of improvement in the last decades, but in particular, in the last decade, there has not only been a continuation of that exponential trend in efficiency of solar panels to the point where they are now cost competitive with fossil fuel power and fossil fuel energy sources, at least in countries that experience the most solar incidents or the most sunlight. But not only that, the worldwide growth of photovoltaic deployments has also been on an exponential curve, at least in the last decade. So during this period of time, photovoltaics, also known as solar PV, has evolved from a niche market of small-scale applications to a mainstream electricity source. Now I'm quoting from Wikipedia here. When solar PV systems were first recognized as a promising renewable energy technology, programs such as feed-in tariffs, these are the subsidies we often hear about, these were implemented by a number of governments in order to provide economic incentives for investments. For several years, growth was mainly driven by Japan and pioneering European countries, obviously Germany being a big one for those following this trend. As a consequence, cost of solar declined significantly due to experience curve effects like improvements in technology and economies of scale. But the countries that pioneered the use of photovoltaics were not necessarily the places that had the most solar energy incidents on the ground. There's a lot of clouds and they're also at higher latitudes that don't have the same solar energy per square meter of ground, even when there are no clouds. And so now what we're seeing is the adoption of these technologies in countries where it makes a lot more sense to have solar installations. And now we're seeing installations in California, in the Middle East, for example, in Dubai, that have costs that are shockingly low in the sense that they are actually lower than fossil fuel installations that would be traditionally used for large-scale power generation. So what we're seeing is finally solar power is ready for the mainstream, and it's not just ready, but it's being implemented. And I think it's worth the Let's Make the Future podcast here to take an episode and discuss what the implications of this family of technologies will be and what the implications will be for society. So maybe I should ask a question, and maybe I should ask, does anyone see any downsides to the use of photovoltaics?
I really like it that we have finally a renewable energy that is basically scalable and also technology-wise ready at the moment. So it's very like critical time for it right now. But there's obvious downsides in the availability. If you look at like when can we produce energy from sunlight, which is naturally bounded by basically hours of sunlight during the day, meaning also dependent on the Earth's position to the sun, but also basically on the weather. So I guess we can say for sure, but maybe it's also an interesting question, how much can we basically get out of sunlight in terms of the market size of energy, and how much do we need to rely on other energies? So I guess that's maybe a downside that it's not always available.
Yeah. One major issue that you already described is that the production of solar energy, especially from the morning until the evening during the day, doesn't always match with the consumption of this energy. So especially here in Germany, we have this problem that the main consumption of households is in the evening, and then the sun isn't shining. So we have this curve of solar energy production, then we have another curve of the personal consumption. And here we have one big issue, because when the peak of the production is very high, or if we have the peak, then the energy isn't able to be used. So one major issue that is related to the solar power industry is, of course, storage. So in the future, batteries and energy storage for those produced energy is one of the biggest issues we have to focus on, I guess.
I suppose the mathematics here are pretty simple. We need to account for the cost of batteries and include that when we think about how solar energy can only be produced at certain times of the day, and then maybe also attach to that some kind of probability distribution associated with the chance that we have so little incidence of sunlight that the batteries actually run out. And so there's maybe some tail end chance that if, let's say, our entire electricity generation system is solar driven, we have batteries that save up that solar energy. But let's say there's, I don't know, somehow 15 days without any sunlight getting to these solar panels for some reason, there's a chance that all the batteries will run out. So anyway, what I'm trying to say is, rather than this being a downside to mean that we always will need some other form of electricity, like nuclear or coal or something else, maybe what we really need to say is, let's reframe this downside in terms of it's an additional cost and an additional probability distribution that we need to take into account.
Yeah, that's a really fun question to think about. Actually, if you would look at what would be the minimal area you would need to use in order to have a fully solar powered community that is living out of solar energy or has ready available solar energy for 99% of the year. I mean, I imagine in my head, I have the picture, you know, when we talked about the arcologies. So basically like a network of arcologies that are completely solar powered over the world and are connected through a grid. Where would they need to be located to maximize the availability of energy? I think that's a fundamental question. You're right.
I suppose another way to overcome this disadvantage is if we have a grid that is so large that areas that are not currently experiencing sunlight will get their energy from other areas where there is. For example, I'm thinking in particular about high voltage direct current technology that allows for very, very long, thousands of kilometers potentially, thousands of kilometers in length, electrical wires that can transmit power from generation, let's say in the middle of the Sahara Desert, all the way over to Europe, in Northern Europe somewhere. And in that way, even if it's a cloudy day, you can still get power even if you have no batteries. It's another option.
I guess this is the vision of the people living in Europe, because I've seen a TED talk about this topic. I guess it was a professor of the Singularity University, and he showed us the area we need to cover with solar panels to create the energy that's needed in Europe the whole day or the whole year. And it's just a few centimeters on this map, and it was just impressive. And yeah, of course, the discussion on how the energy comes to the place where it's needed, this is very interesting because, yeah.
Now, a few centimeters on a map. Toby, I have to ask, what is the scale of this map?
I would say it's about 1/20th of the part of Europe, or maybe even smaller, much smaller.
I see.
Fully covered.
Still
in
that. Depends, yeah. I have to admit that even though that's not as bad as it could be, that's still a lot of land to cover. I wonder if, again, it might make more sense to cover the desert or something where nothing is happening rather than to cover up 1/20th of Europe, which is, of course, full of people and things. But yes, that's a good point.
I guess the problem is that you, like, geographically, you need to diversify your grid, because if you put a lot into a desert, you might be good for, it might be like a 80-20 thing that you might be good for most of the time, but you will have a big problem if then some bad weather issue happens there, because you're dependent on that location. Another thing I'm thinking about that plays right into the same discussion, basically, is what Toby also mentioned earlier, the thing about storage. I'm, for example, also wondering and also thinking about the carbon footprint heavy process of storage. How will a rise of renewable energies or solar energy contribute to storage? And how will that look like? Will we be able to produce it in a more sustainable way? And if not, it might probably not be a good thing if we, for example, identify that an increase in use of solar energy will result in a direct increase of batteries needed to be used. Do you have any opinions on this, if how that interplays with storage?
Maybe our society has to change a bit, our habits when we work, when we produce something, because it doesn't mean if we have a lot of production of this solar power that we have to store it and use it when we need to it. I guess the future is, of course, a smart grid where every company or big factories, big manufacturers know when energy is available and then produce when the energy is there and when it's cheap. For example, aluminium production is very energy intensive. And currently, I don't know how it's worldwide, but in Germany, it's produced in the night because no one else is using this energy that is available. And it's very cheap to do it. And maybe in the future, those businesses have to adapt and use the energy when it's needed or when it's available. And there we have also a connection to the mobility sector, that we have to charge electric cars, but in the end, it doesn't matter when we charge them. So plugging in the night is just dumb because we have to store the batteries and then take the energy from the batteries to the cars. We just plug them in when the sun is shining, for example, at work or if you're working from at home. So it's a complete change in the society.
Like, if we had a smarter grid that was capable of incentivizing these sorts of behaviors, like charging cars only at certain times or doing things only at off-peak hours, and if there were the right incentives, it does seem like people might change their behavior. Or if we had more technologies that were able to take advantage of charging during off-peak hours, etc., it does seem like we could change our behavior. I wonder if that would have only a marginal impact on our energy consumption, or if that would have a dramatic impact. I'm not quite sure. So for context, why don't you respond to that? Sorry.
Oh, no, I wanted to know which exact scenario you were thinking about in terms of the impact, like what kind of smart grid, or did you have anything in mind, or was it more like general abstract question?
Yeah, I guess I'm thinking about, well, I like the example of charging cars. So I know if you do a graph of power consumption over the course of the day, that power consumption is happening most, I think, in the evening, I believe. And so if you can avoid having cars be charged in the evening, even if you get home from work at 6 p.m. and you plug in your car, if you can wait until 1 a.m. to charge, or if there can be some kind of stepped progression where like some number of the cars are at a certain time and some other, like I wonder if you can set a setting on your various applications to say, listen to information from the grid to decide when to apply the charging or something. And maybe there's some information back and forth that's being sent from a central coordinating authority that's coordinating the charging for these things. If you supply the parameters that you have, like, oh, I'm going to leave this plugged in for 10 hours. So you can decide which 1 hour block or which pieces of time that add up to 1 hour need to be allocated to me. And I wonder if we can have a very sophisticated grid like that, if maybe that will cut the need for a peak power generation, which of course drives the whole needed capacity of any power system. I wonder if that could drop the needed peak generation capacity by a large percentage. Maybe it could make it half the size or maybe a third the size. I don't know, if the use of power was much, much more efficient somehow like that.
For a given probability.
Or how about this? What about air conditioners? Sorry to jump on that, but what about like in office buildings, you have an air conditioner, right? And it runs and then it turns off and it's on like a, what is that called? A control system where it detects what the temperature, it's the thermostat, right? So it detects the temperature and then it starts up if the temperature has risen above a threshold and then it stops if it falls below that threshold. So I wonder if these thermostats were all networked together, if they could decide at the right times when to start and stop. So like maybe it could even cut peak power need by some huge amount if they could all be coordinated in the way that they maybe tolerate being slightly hotter at certain times, but in order to make it so that no more than half of them are on at a given time or something. Whereas right now, of course, it's all completely unconnected and they're not talking to one another.
Yeah, I think exactly what you're saying is a data problem, like a big data problem, not like a big problem, but like a big data problem. And I think actually Google has been working on this for their own server houses. I think I remember like a news coming like 1 or 2 years ago where they said that they built an AI to basically optimize energy consumption from their cooling systems there. And I think they were able to actually decrease peak time and decrease overall energy usage by around 60%, if I remember correctly. So yeah, there's definitely a lot of potential and it actually also is already being used, just maybe not on scale. But I really like this smart grid idea, not just because it's a very fun mathematical problem, but also because it's basically all plays into this solar economy, I would say, that makes everything very, yeah, that basically we like have an interesting market and with interesting market effects there. But I wonder maybe how much if one would implement something like this free solar market dominated by private players, would be enough to have overall positive effects, or if, for example, influence of government or politics is needed to reduce overall costs, basically, or improve the overall efficiency of the whole grid, basically. For example, by shifting the interests to basically charge during the day, where you would need less storage because you could use, what Toby said earlier, the solar energy right away. So do you have any opinions on this?
I guess the first step from the governmental point of view is already done, because I don't know how it's in the US or in Canada, but here in Germany, if you build a new house, for example, we are living in a quite new house here, for the recent 5 to 10 years, or I guess 5 years, you have to install a smart meter. So your energy provider knows exactly when you use energy and how much energy you use. And I guess this is the first step towards this data issue you already mentioned, Daniel, that we need to know when the energy is consumed, and then we have to optimize it. And maybe then, after we have this databases, you know exactly where we have to install which amount of solar panels or other renewable energy resources.
So I think we have someone that's joined us here. Annie, hello. Now, she may not have a microphone, or he.
Or it, if it's the same bot as last time.
Yes, that's right. Okay, well, welcome. And you can feel free to add your textual comments, if you will. We have, once again, a mysterious artificial intelligence that has joined us by the name of Annie. So, hello, hello. Okay. I just want to make an observation that maybe our AI friend will appreciate, because this is to do with numbers. So let's just talk about the scale of solar energy for a moment. In the year 2000, there was about 0 gigawatt hours of installed capacity in the world that was solar panels. In 2010, that was up to 50 gigawatt hours. And now in 2017, we're up to 250. So that's fivefold growth in 7 years, which is pretty amazing. But now for scale, this is still approximately 0.1% of the total installed capacity on the planet. So there is still a huge scope for growth. There's approximately 250,000 gigawatt hours of power generation in the whole world. So 250,000 total, 250 coming from solar panels.
I think that's still a pretty good numbers in terms, if you look at who basically has driven this growth so far, because I think it was mostly like the early adopters were probably mostly people that were more interested in the green effects of solar energy. But now, as we talked about earlier, like the scalability is basically ready through being very cost efficient and easy to install, and also storage becoming cheaper. So I think right now it has also become interesting for the economic buyer, basically. So I think we will see much larger growth now, and also particularly for countries. I mean, there's also, you always need to consider that there's a large part of the, okay, that's maybe an interesting question, but that will be maybe one step too far. But there's still a large part of the earth where technology-wise, they're not there where developed countries are. And also, maybe that's an interesting question to ask and to think about how to incentivize them not doing the same history as we did to start with more carbon-heavy energy, how do you say, production, but go right away into solar energy production. So maybe that's something to think about, how to incentivize that. And then I think we will probably see an even larger growth if something like that will be manageable.
Given the costs involved, it seems like there's probably no need for what was taking place in decades past, which was subsidization by governments and incentives like you're referring to. I think it seems to me like the only incentive that will be needed will be the fact that solar energy is cheaper, and then it will be widely adopted. In fact, in 2050, or by 2050, solar power is anticipated to become the world's largest source of electricity. Now, this will require growing our capacity from, as I say, the current base of approximately 250 gigawatt hours to something that's much, much more than that. And that's going to take a huge amount of capital investment. And I think businesses that relate to solar panel installations and solar panels, I think, are going to be on an enormous growth charge in the next 30 years for sure.
Yeah, but I still think, I mean, I guess we agree that with highest probabilities, this will be a good fact, the high growth there. But the interesting thing would be to like accelerate the growth, or like bring like the major part of the growth to as soon as possible. So to like accelerate that.
So why would we do it as soon as possible? Just for climate change?
Yeah, mostly for climate change. Yeah, I think so.
I wonder if there's a downside there in that with solar panels decreasing in cost every year exponentially, if we spend a lot of our money right now on existing technology, maybe we're not leaving enough powder dry, so to speak, for 5 years from now. And if, let's say, we just kept the money in the bank and waited 5 years, we might actually end up with more solar panel capacity if we spend the money on 5 years later technology than on the panel installations today.
Interesting. I thought there was like a natural life cycle of solar panels, or like photovoltaic cells, that was like around 20 years. So that would mean that it would, in that sense, maybe be a, like a smaller effect. That obviously in the long term, that's something that is, and we're talking about the long term here. So that's definitely something which would need refined analysis. True.
I'd like to take the conversation in a slightly different direction now and ask a different question, if you don't mind. I'd like to ask about the implications of this technology on human society, in particular on the political economy and on international relations, because we've been in a paradigm of fossil fuels, an oil paradigm, for the last 150 years or so. And for maybe 70 of those years, oil has been produced in the Middle East. And so that's an area that I think will be undergoing some pretty dramatic changes in the next 30 years, because the foundations of their society, the subsidized jobs that a lot of people have in Saudi Arabia, for example, and in other countries in the Gulf there, are all connected to petroleum jobs and petroleum generation. And so with all that gone, do you think that that will change those countries? Will it lead to those governments being overthrown? Will it lead to emigration? And I wonder if other countries will be beneficiaries of this. So I suppose we need to think about countries where they have a lot of days of sunlight per year, but also maybe no oil right now. And I suppose those countries are best poised in the future to be more prosperous. So maybe countries like Egypt, for example, which never experienced the same oil boom that the Gulf did, but they certainly have large swathes of territory that get a lot of sunlight, and maybe other countries also in the Sahara, but perhaps other places as well. So I wonder what your thoughts are on the political situation.
That's an interesting question to think about. So I think I generally like being less dependent on smaller parts of the world. It would be, again, like a better economy, because I think or have better economic properties, because it's more efficient in terms of time or market efficiency to probably transport energy. But I like when the dependence on the energy is basically becoming more decentralized. And I think that will be the responsibility more into the countries and areas' hands. And basically, yeah, I think that will be, how do I phrase this?
Well, Daniel, don't you think... Go ahead. Yes, sorry, I'm interrupting you. You'll think it will be.
Go ahead. What did you want to say?
I just wanted to challenge you on the idea that we will have a model, and that maybe we should be thinking about this. How will the solar generation capacity be built out? Will it be the decentralized approach that you're talking about, which you're right, will sort of remove energy politics from the world a little bit? If everyone is producing power very close to home, then there isn't this dynamic of a country getting rich from another country having to spend its wealth on energy produced in a different country. Instead, everyone will pay their own dues, so to speak. So in that sense, I think it will be stabilizing after a period of perhaps instability in the areas that previously had this benefit. But I wonder if that's even going to be the case, because the incidence of solar energy does not fall equally around the world. And you can look on a map of the world that shows average annual solar irradiance in kilowatt hours per meter squared, for example. I'm looking at a chart right now. That's why I'm able to say that. And you can see that in more northern latitudes, it's far, far less. So a country like, well, sorry, but a country like Germany might have a really hard time actually getting all of its capacity from solar panels. And a country like Egypt would have a very easy time doing that. In fact, it's probably already today cost competitive for them to swap out their network as things become obsolete in the next decades.
So basically, you're
So there's two models. So model one would be the decentralized model you're referring to, that regardless of average solar irradiance, people will still install capacity close to home. But model two might be that instead we get these giant solar facilities built in countries that have more solar radiation, and they send that electricity to other countries, which is very similar to what we have now, where oil is drilled in countries that have oil and sent to countries that do not have oil.
I guess we will have a huge disruption in this market, and I'm a huge fan of this decentralized approach, because if we make the renewable energy industry the same as the fossil fuel industry, we will, like you already told, have the same political issues in this world. And this is one of the most important aspects of renewable energy, and especially solar power, that you can install it where you want it, and especially there where you need it. So first of all, I also think that solar power isn't the only resource of energy. We have a lot more, and the combination of all will be the perfect match. So I don't think that a country like Egypt, of course, who has a lot of space and a lot of sun done for solar power, but not the industry and not the people who will need this energy will produce energy for other countries and bring it there via expensive and maybe inefficient grid. So the future will be that every country will gain independence. And this is the coolest thing about renewable energies.
Yeah, so that's a similar opinion as I had. So one additional question is, for example, in countries with less sunlight, do there tend to be less resources, for example? Or, for example, if we look at countries that have typically less sunlight, do there naturally appear energy resources that they could leverage? Or would there be like long-term losers from basically the shift to renewable energies, I wonder?
Yeah, I guess the discussion is not where the most sunlight is and where the most space for those solar panels is, but who produces those solar panels. I have the same discussions every day when it comes to battery electric cars, where the cells for the batteries get produced. And these will be the interesting countries that have more power than others. So, for example, if all the cells come from South Korea or Japan, they have more power than other countries and they have a better market position. Maybe the same will appear with the production of solar panels. Of course, this is in the future when we have produced every solar panel we need, then this discussion is over. But I guess we won't experience that moment in our lives.
So what you're saying is basically that the long-term beneficiaries or beneficiary countries or like market leaders in energy will like shift one step up in the supply chain. Basically, they will not be the one with the energy resources, but they will be the ones making these energy resources available.
Yeah, because solar is everywhere. Of course, other countries have more sun, but I guess this isn't the most important thing. Space, every country has space. On the roofs, maybe on the streets, maybe on lands. This is one of the major things to understand about solar power, that everyone can produce it right away. I mean, here in Germany, we have nearly, especially in Bavaria, on the countryside, we have nearly on every farm solar panels on the roof. And it's just awesome. And they are all producing the energy for themselves and even getting energy back to the grid. And it's not like we would depend on a much bigger state far, far away with a little bit more sun. Of course, a little bit is a bit underestimated, but yeah, but we should use this decentralization aspect and never, ever about this new energy industry like the one we have currently.
Yeah, so that's actually very true that here in Bavaria and also in Austria, there's ridiculously many solar panels. If you like drive through the fields, basically every house has solar panels. And also, just as a quick side note, my dad actually texted me today that today, for the first time, when the weather got worse after some time, was the day when the battery that he installed earlier this year was at 0% charge. So he was basically living completely off the grid for over 3 months. So just as a side note about, because you're like talking again and again about like Germany being not the best place, which is true, but people are still invested in it. I think Parni joined. Hi, Parni. How's it going?
Hi, Parni.
Hello. How are you?
Good morning. We're doing well. We're just discussing solar energy.
That's great.
So feel free to jump in.
So we're talking right now about how the future of, if like with a shift to renewable energies, how a future would look like in a global sense, which countries would be maybe more like long-term winners out of this in, for example, a decentralized scenario, and how exactly this would look like. Do you have any opinions on this?
I guess we might combine AI for distributing solar energy or kind of like for the optimization. I'm not entirely sure, so I can't say anything right now because I just jump in, so give me some thought.
We'll let you keep thinking, but in fact, the idea of intelligently optimizing where the power is going was what we were just talking about earlier, so you're right on the mark with that comment for sure. So I have a thought about this in the sense that we want to think about what power is used for, because after all, power is just a means to an end, and we often think about climate change and the impact of climate change, and one thing people talk about is water and how we will see desertification and places where it's harder to get water. And even just forgetting about climate change, there are currently places in the world where it's hard to get access to clean, potable water. And if you think about it, the generation of clean water, like it's often thought of as a finite resource and something that has to be husbanded very carefully. But as long as you have access to an ocean, a clean water problem is purely an energy problem because you can just throw desalinization technology at the problem. And the problem with desalinization, though, is that it does take a lot of energy to run the facility. And so you end up making very, very expensive clean water. So with the advent of these solar panels, and if they're continue to get cheaper, then we may end up in a world where energy is cheap enough and can be produced in a decentralized fashion wherever it's needed. And we may end up in a world where the water crisis that was predicted to happen in the 21st century will not come to pass, because desalinization technology combined with decentralized solar panel technology will make it possible to create all the water that anyone needs, anywhere they need it. I'm thinking specifically about Israel, where they don't have any fossil fuels available, nor do they have any real sources of potable water. And they're leaders, therefore, in the desalinization technology movement. And it seems to me like if they had solar panels, they could combine that with their desalinization. And I'm sure they've thought of this, but that's exactly, I think, the way out of the problem.
I'm a huge fan of the statement, and because I thought a lot about this topic recently. And I think that, okay, we have this picture of the future, this vision that the decrease of energy costs will plummet and this will continue and energy will get cheaper, solar panels will get cheaper, wind power will get cheaper. And I have this statement, and maybe you can challenge me about that, that if we forget the political dumbness of a lot of people that we fight against each other for no real reason, if we have very cheap or maybe even free energy on this world, we could solve every single problem. Every single problem is based on energy. We could solve everything if we won't be people.
Toby, can I challenge you on that or ask you maybe just for more information? Like, can we think of other problems that are often framed as major cataclysmic societal issues, but that could just be thought of as energy problems? I mean, I talked about clean water, but are there others? Okay.
I guess you have this vertical farms where you can produce a lot of food and it's only based on water and energy. And here we have two issues we could solve. And I guess thinking about this is very complex because, of course, we have this developed countries and we have this developing countries who have very different problems, and we have to get this energy to those places. But so the realization of this statement is very difficult because you have to install, for example, solar panels or wind turbines everywhere in this planet to make energy available everywhere. But okay, these labor costs, for example, are a bit difficult. But if we make this possible, that of course, it's just an utopia and it's not really realistic, but I think you could solve every problem with it. Food and water are the most important things.
It's true. And yet, well, let me ask you this, though.
Yeah.
The production of batteries and other sensitive electronics, the kind that we use and we talk about with all these exponential technologies, they require rare earth minerals and specific elements. And a lot of things are just energy problems, for sure. I totally agree with you. But the mining of rare earth minerals, I don't think can be transformed into just an energy problem unless we, I guess, use fusion or something to create our own elements. But I can't imagine that that would ever be economical to do, and mining will always be the better option. But can we see that potentially being the limiting factor in some of this?
I guess we are just focusing on e-mobility currently because fuel cell cars are some kind of waste of energy, because a lot of energy is needed to produce hydrogen. But in the best case, we won't be dependent on batteries, because we would have fuel cell cars and produce those hydrogen and store it in the cars. And of course, I know you also need a small battery, and I have no answer to that question, but it's not that big of an issue like a Tesla currently. And maybe, yeah, if we have this future of a lot of energy available, then we won't use battery electric cars. Okay, this is a straight answer to your question, but workaround.
That's cool. That's cool. So I do want to take the conversation in a slightly different direction, because we've been talking a lot about solar panels. And I think we've been talking about this in relation to the idea of decentralized power generation and how it will alter human society, it will alter world politics. And we're optimists on this show, I think. So I think we believe that that will be a positive development for global stability, because if people are generating that power closer to home, that's a good thing. But I want to take the last 10 minutes of our show to just talk about, is solar panel or solar energy the only option here? Because we've seen some pretty amazing developments in nuclear energy also, which is another clean energy that doesn't emit carbon into the air. And it's been subject to a lot of venture capital investment, new kinds of nuclear energy that are lower in capacity than the previous huge plants, but that are instead small modular reactors. And they're designed to be a fraction of the size of the multi-gigawatt plants that used to be constructed and used to experience huge cost overruns. And instead, because they can be built like in a factory assembly line, instead of using civil engineers and giant building with all kinds of characteristics that need to be taken into account, because they can be built in an assembly line at a smaller scale, there's all kinds of economies of scale that can be reaped by that, because they're being produced identically over and over again. So you end up with 30 to 300 megawatt nuclear plants that, instead of using electrically operated pumps and motors to circulate coolant and to keep the core of the nuclear reactor at a low temperature, which is what happens in traditional plants, these small reactors, they use no pumps and they use no motors, and instead rely on passive means such as gravity and conduction to cool the reactors. So I just want to explore the idea that our energy future may not be solar and may in fact be something like nuclear. Perhaps at the bottom of every new condo will be a small nuclear reactor that powers that condominium building.
May I add something? I guess it's a really good idea. Also, if you can bring us some ideas for a 30-second pitch, if anybody interested.
What do you mean exactly?
So we used to have like brainstorming ideas at the end of conversation.
We wanted to talk about a few minutes more.
I have to say, I do agree, Parni, and I think we should have the business plan competition. So you're totally right. Maybe I can just ask Daniel and Toby, do you have any more comments about my nuclear bombshell that I just dropped? And then we can switch gears and do our elevator pitch battle.
I want to talk about it, not because I have a lot of knowledge in this area, but I'm very interested in this topic. I recently had a discussion also in this house. We're living here together. And for me, nuclear energy isn't a clean energy. Of course, you don't have this carbon emissions, but in the recent years, in the past, we created a lot of dump from or stuff out of this production that we can't control. We have to store it here in this world. I guess if we talk about nuclear fission, then this is a big problem. So in my point of view of the future, this isn't an alternative. Even though it sounds interesting, even though we make a lot of progress in this area, and I'm pretty aware of this topic that we have, especially in these developing countries, the need of a lot of energy. And we are not fast enough to build up those solar panels, those wind turbines, and those renewable energies. And maybe it can't go without those nuclear power. But we have to work every day to not let this happen, that a lot of more reactors are in this world. So maybe nuclear fusion is another aspect. Maybe you know more about it. And this has a lot of advantages, and that the waste that is created there isn't that bad for such a long time like nuclear fission. So this would be some kind of improvement. But in general, if it's a discussion between solar power and nuclear power, there is only one alternative and we have to focus on one. Maybe this sounds some kind of idealistic and optimistic, but I think nuclear isn't a power humanity can control. Even though we make progress and we think now it's perfect, and then we forgot something and a catastrophe is happening. And I have this clear statement, nuclear isn't made for human.
It does seem like prices are going to answer the question for us, because if solar energy is cheaper, then by all means, it will be our future. I agree with that.
How about if we are putting the dump in space?
How do we get it to space? It seems a little dangerous.
Yeah, dump of nuclear energy. So,
in my mind, the nuclear waste storage issue has always been a bit of a red herring, because there's all kinds of land available for us to store things that we don't want anyone to look at. I think the bigger issue is whether we can construct nuclear plants that are cheap enough to be cost competitive with some of this new solar energy that's coming on stream. And I think it may only make sense in certain applications, like, for example, in factories that require a huge amount of energy, like maybe data centers that are located far away from population centers, or maybe in countries that don't experience much sunlight, like Norway or other countries in the north or in the far south, I suppose. These places, it'll probably make more sense to consider nuclear energy. But if the exponential trend of a decreasing cost of solar power continues, I think that's going to answer all of our questions for us. And I think that's the new reality that we need to adjust to, because if you formed your opinion about solar energy 10 years ago, or even 5 years ago, then it's time, apparently, to update your assessment, because as we summarized at the beginning of the show, the technology has really improved, and it's at this point very cost competitive. So with that, unless somebody has something else to say, why don't we just close the show with a elevator pitch battle.
I think it would be a very good point. It was a nice statement you made there at the end. So I'm fine with that.
Yeah.
Cool.
Me too. It was an interesting conversation. Okay. Really appreciate
okay,
it.
Okay, so then, all right, great. Sorry to talk over you there. It's just a latency. I apologize. So the object here is to come up with, let's say you're in an elevator with Bill Gates and you want to convince him of an idea that you have for something related to solar energy. And we want to hear your pitch. We're going to evaluate the pitches at the end. We're going to vote for the best pitch. So I'll let everybody take 1 minute to think of an idea. All right. Is everyone ready?
Maybe.
I think so, yeah.
Okay. Well, I can start if that helps anybody having a little bit more time to think about their idea.
It's time for the elevator pitch battle. Let's begin. Round one. Michael Curry.
Well, you've probably heard of carbon offset nonprofits where you give them money and they'll plant a forest or something to offset your carbon emissions. So what about a not-for-profit that takes your money and gives it to people in countries where there's a high incidence of solar radiation to install solar panels? So instead of you being environmentally conscious and installing a solar panel in Scotland, you instead take the same money that you would have spent, or maybe 60% of the money, or a fifth of the money, and hand this to the not-for-profit, and they instead install solar panels in a place where it would make far more sense to install it, and for far less money, you get the same carbon offsetting impact.
Hmm. That's a cool idea. Mine goes in a similar direction. Should I go next? Or does anybody have questions about the idea?
Go ahead.
Round two. Daniel Valenzuela.
Okay, so I would try to convince Bill Gates in the elevator to invest in my also like a social startup where we would provide fully, like easily installed, fully managed solar solutions to countries, mostly targeted countries that are basically like still in the beginning of building up their energy infrastructure. So the key interesting thing would be a dynamic pricing where it would make it very attractive for countries. So that will make it easily attractive for all kinds of countries. Also for countries that might have maybe less ROI for usual solar solutions. So yeah, basically to incentivize the use of solar energy more early. Actually, that idea made more sense when I thought about it. Right now when I say it, it makes less sense because you don't want to incentivize where it's so much, where it's less needed to use. But that's kind of the idea, to like incentivize it over a larger area, basically. You know, yeah.
Because of climate change, you think that it's so important to do this that even if it doesn't make economic sense, you want to put it there. Yeah, got it.
Yeah, exactly.
And maybe that avoids the problem that I have in my idea where I'm proposing that we give money to places where they would want to install solar panels anyway. So maybe there's no offset taking place at all if I'm just giving money to someone that would already be offsetting or would already be switching to solar panels. So I kind of like your idea better in some ways. Okay, sorry. So yeah, Toby, you were saying you want to go next. Go ahead.
Round three, Tobias Wagner.
Now, I have this idea of the Airbnb for sun power. And I think that everyone who owns their own photovoltaic on their rooftop worldwide should be an own entrepreneur, should be their own businessman, and they can trade the energy with all the other people. So maybe the panels are larger than the energy is needed in the house, then you can sell it via those platforms to other people all around the world. For example, if you have too much energy maybe stored in your basement, then you can sell it to other people based on the smart grid. So everyone is their own businessman and sells their own energy.
And how exactly would that?
Well, but the worldwide is of course not possible currently because we don't have the grid connection. But here, this renewable energy topic is possible here in Germany. That the energy you don't use, you get it back to the grid and another house can use it for you.
But Airbnb sounds always like there's human interaction into it. How efficient would it be?
No, okay. So you can set your own price or you can make it by an algorithm who defines the best price currently between supply and demand. So it's just maybe the feeling of Airbnb, you just use this house for energy on your own house. And maybe it's just a buzzword to make it more sustainable.
So Toby, I suppose you're talking about a smart grid, which is, that's the idea, right? A smart grid that lets you pay back or put energy back into the grid, so to speak. Although it's more like an energy trading thing between individuals, but it's in a sense similar. I guess it requires that infrastructure to be present, right? The power system to allow for that, I suppose.
I haven't thought about it in detail, but I guess with the current grid we have, as only talking about Germany, it is possible that it's just some kind of balancing how much other households households are requiring energy. And I guess this is working because, yeah, you get the energy back to the grid and maybe other households rise up their consumption because they have their car charging. Then they use this energy that is produced by a house downside the street. I guess this is currently possible.
I just want to flash my finance knowledge for a sec because I think the correct term for your idea, Toby, is the power company or the power transmission company would be a novated exchange for the facilitation of these peer-to-peer transactions. So you would be putting your energy into the grid, and everyone would be, but the transactions would be netted by the grid to facilitate the peer-to-peer transactions that you're referring to. But that's, anyway, it's an interesting idea. I'm just thinking about it now. Okay, so Parni, you have an idea and I want to hear it.
Round 4, Parni on Barricatain.
It's going to be a flying car or drones that they charge solar panels, or maybe they can make energy to their own turbines if they're strong enough, and then they can distribute that energy to households. Well, actually, maybe they can be one big turbine. There's like a startup I've seen before. If you go above atmosphere, they can create energy, and then there's like lots of small kind of like flying cars come over and distribute that energy to households.
Oh, that like challenges the idea of basically solar panels being immobile. So basically, how can you maybe make solar panels get more sunlight during the day by making them move and kind of like transmit the energy or store the energy?
Or there's also the laser turbines. I forget the name. So there's a startup back in Boston, I know, 2 years ago. So they also put up big turbines, and they go like up to atmosphere, and then because there's like lots of wind there, they generate lots of energy, and they all constantly like generate like energy, and they're much powerful than wind power that exists in sort of like in the current like land and with less noise. So those are really interesting approach because you can move them also like anywhere you want. The point that you can have a smaller kind of energy storage from those, or even solar panel that can flying over and then distribute energy.
I think that's a fascinating idea. And I also think the mathematics of analyzing in concentric circles radiating out from the source of the power, the solar panel source of the power, how much energy could be delivered by taking drones to fly batteries to those locations. Because of course there would be a drop off because it takes power to power the drones themselves. And so I wonder if you could run that calculation to see the concentric circles, and like you could deliver this many, this percent of the original power generation this far away and this percent this far away. I think it's a fascinating idea.
Okay. Exactly the same thing I was thinking about as well. Yeah. I think that's fascinating or fun or whatever you want to name it. Yeah.
Awesome. I have to run, but it was nice to see you all.
Do you have time to take the vote right now?
Yes.
Okay. Because then we're done. So everyone on the count of three, please state the name of the person that you want to vote for. Is it Michael with carbon offset solar power? Is it Daniel with a social charity to pay marginal countries to get solar power? Is it Toby with his Airbnb for solar power? Or is it Parni with flying solar power delivered to your door? Okay, so on 3, 2, 1, everyone come up with a name first that you're going to say. And on the count of three, okay, 3, 2, 1.
Parni.
Parni. Parni, who did you vote for?
Toby.
Ooh.
And everyone else voted for Parni?
Yep. Yeah. Clear winner. That's nice.
Congratulations, Parni.
Thank you.
And thank you, everybody. I had a great time talking about solar energy.
Yeah, it was extremely fun. Also, Parni's idea really like gave me some new things to think about. That's really fun. And also, thanks to Toby again. I think I catch him like 45 minutes before the talk and surprised him with his attendance now. So thanks for the flexibility. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Toby.
Yeah, I'm very thankful
to
get in contact with you all. And thank you for your time. Really appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right. Bye, guys.
Cool. See have a good later. Evening. Bye.
Bye. Good evening and good morning, Parni. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Let's make the future.